Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Cold as Ice by Julie Mulhern. Narrated by Callie Beaulieu. 1. November, 1974. Kansas City, Missouri. The awful thing about murder, aside from the dead body, devastated families, and blood, is that one never knows when violent death will visit. For example, if one knew that someone would die on Tuesday night, one could pay particular attention to conversations and expressions and emotions. One might be able to stop a crime or unveil a killer. Of course, it's impossible to know ahead of time, but one does get feelings of impending disaster, with a capital D and an exclamation point. I sensed disaster at precisely 6:30 on Friday night. If I'd known what kind of disaster was coming, I would have ignored the doorbell and barricaded the door, or grabbed my daughter Grace and taken her on an impromptu trip to Timbuktu. But I didn't know. Happy in my ignorance, I opened the door and found Trip Michaels on my front stoop. He stood there, looking like David Cassidy's more handsome younger brother, brown hair, piercing blue eyes, corduroy pants, navy peacoat, and penny loafers. No wonder Grace had fallen for him. At 16, I would have done the same, but hard-won experience had taught me that beautiful men were untrustworthy. Lord New Henry, my late husband, had been both beautiful and untrustworthy. He turned our marriage into a disaster. Marriage to Henry was a disaster with 3 exclamation points. Trip cleared his throat. I stopped ruminating. He extended his hand. It's nice to see you, Mrs. Russell. Definitely untrustworthy. The boy was up to something. That, or the baggage I carried with me, was coloring my view of a perfectly nice kid. I shook his hand. Come in, Trip. Grace should be right down. Maybe. Grace had blasted through her closet in search of the perfect outfit, and her room looked like the aftermath of an explosion, the casualties being tried on and discarded clothes. How hard was it to decide what to wear on a date? Grace told me you're going to the movies. What are you seeing? Benji. My dog, Max, eyed Trip suspiciously. His tail didn't wag, nor did he offer his customary crotch sniff as welcome. Instead, he stayed glued to my side. Of late, I'd questioned Max's judgment. Should I trust his doggy sense now? I crossed the foyer and called up the stairs. Grace! Hurry up! Trip is here! I'll be right down! Trip's gaze traveled the front hall, taking in the sparkle of the chandelier, the flower arrangement on the Bombay chest, and the painting that hung above it. Is that one of yours? My gaze followed his to the Jackson Pollock hanging on the wall. My paintings weren't abstract. No. And then, because standing around in an uncomfortable silence made me itch, I asked, what time does your movie start? 8:00. We're going to grab a quick dinner before the show. Innocuous words. Dinner and a movie. What could be wrong with that? Plenty. So, tell me, Trip. I'm ready. Grace rushed down the stairs wearing a pair of jeans and a peasant blouse. For this, she'd trashed her room. Grace pulled a coat from the hall closet, turned and noticed my dress. Oh, right, you have that cocktail party. All I wanted was a glass of wine, my feet up, and an episode of the Rockford Files. Completely doable if I hadn't promised my friend Libba I'd go to the Brookfields party with her. Libba had eagerly adopted Sex and the Single Girl as a personal manifesto, but she still couldn't walk into a party alone. She was counting on me. Will you be out late? Grace asked. No, I'm exhausted. I'm just going to put in an appearance, then come home. No need for Trip to think my house was empty and unsupervised. I'd already caught the two of them making out on the couch once. When will you be home? By 11:30. She coupled the world-weary tone of a teenager forced to answer a rhetorical question with an epic eye roll. Not a minute later. That earned a second eye roll. I'll have her home on time, Mrs. Russell. Tripp's smile probably inspired confidence with most mothers, not with me. You two have fun, but not too much fun. They slipped through the front door, leaving behind the scent of Grace's Love's Baby Soft and a lingering sense of unease. I closed the door. I don't know, Max. There's something about that kid I don't like. Max whined softly, reminding me I never liked any of Grace's potential boyfriends. Come on, I said. I need a sandwich before I go. The Brookfields' parties tended to be heavy on liquor and light on food. With the mere mention of a sandwich, Max followed me to the kitchen and carefully supervised the construction of turkey, Swiss mayo, and a slice of tomato on rye. He wagged his tail, hopefully. Ding dong! I handed over the crusts of my sandwich to Max and hurried into the foyer. Ding dong! Ding dong! I yanked open the door. I can't believe you made me get out of the car. I've been honking for ages. I glanced at my watch, and my smart retort faded away. Libba was early. Libba was early. Somewhere in hell they were having a heck of a snowball fight. And somewhere at the Brookfields was a man Libba fancied. I knew it as surely as I knew my dress was black. You're wearing that? She asked. I smoothed the silk jersey over my hips. Yes, it was new. It was flattering. It wasn't low cut. Now Libba glanced at her watch. It'll have to do. Let's go. A smile lurked at the corners of her lips, the kind of smile a woman wears when she's infatuated with a man. Who is he? Who is who? Libba sounded innocent, but I wasn't fooled. The man. There's no man. The smile still lurked on her lips. Uh-huh, I smirked. Just drop it, Ellison. I didn't need to pester her. The party would tell the tale. I slipped into a coat and picked up my handbag. Let's go. If the weather had been pleasant, we could have walked to the Brookfields' house, but the frigid air was heavy with impending snow. We climbed into Libba's car, and she torpedoed us the few blocks to the Brookfields. When we arrived, I opened the passenger door and put one grateful foot on the frozen pavement. You nearly hit that Volvo. I did not. She had. The Volvo's side mirror probably retained the cherry red kiss of her BMW's mirror. Did, too. You're in a mood. She got out of the car and slammed her door. I'm not the only one. I gently closed the passenger door. I'm not staying late. Oh, I'm tired. I'll stay long enough to be polite, then call a cab. Fine. Libba didn't mind being at a party by herself, just arriving alone. We walked up to the front door, anticipatory salt crunching beneath the soles of our shoes, and rang the bell. Kay Brookfield opened the door wearing a stylish camel dress and a bright smile. Welcome! Come in out of the cold. We stepped into the warmth and light of the Brookfields foyer, surrendered our coats, and accepted drinks from a waiter holding a silver tray, a stinger for Libba, wine for me. I'm so glad you got back from New York in time to come, said Kay. Me too. I'd had a successful gallery opening and only arrived home that morning. I wouldn't have missed this for anything, except the Rockford files. Everyone's in the living room. With a broad sweep of her arm, Kay indicated where she wanted us. I lingered. The house looks lovely, and the flowers. I nodded at an enormous arrangement of Mum's salmon-hued roses and bittersweet, positioned on a round table near the base of the stairs. They're gorgeous. Thank you. I'm glad they turned out. A devilish grin lit Kay's face, and I'm glad you didn't find any dead people on the driveway. Ah, the night's still young. Libba's comment wiped the grin clear off Kay's lips. We left her with a worried furrow in her brow. That wasn't very nice, I said. Pish! Libba rolled her eyes with every bit as much drama as Grace. You find a body nearly every week. I figure you're due. God forbid. Kay's living room wouldn't have been out of place in an English country house. A bottle green velvet sofa edged in burgundy sat at a 90-degree angle to a chintz sofa in shades of burgundy cream and that same bottle green. Above that chintz sofa hung a gilt frame, and in the frame hung a painting of dyspeptic sheep. The velvet drapes were hung high, closer to the ceilings than the actual windows. A fire blazed in the stone hearth, and an arched doorway led to a paneled library. Chester, the bartender who worked most of the parties I attended, was set up in the corner. He saw me and smiled warmly. His expression was in stark contrast to Prudence Davies, who saw me, narrowed her eyes, and blew a plume of cigarette smoke in my direction. Prudence was one of the women with whom my beautiful and untrustworthy husband had dallied. Dallied. Such a nice word. It sounded like springtime and sunshine and daffodils. The reality had been sordid. Prudence was talking with Paula Stanton and Jenny Woods, and neither of them looked happy about it, I shifted my gaze, taking in the crowd. Laird Williams, a friend of Henry's, clutched an old-fashioned filled with scotch and prognosticated about Saturday's football games with Tom Michaels, Tripp's father. Laird's wife, Evelyn, stood with them. The poor woman looked bored beyond measure. Laurie Michaels chatted with my friend Daisy and, my heart hiccuped, Hunter Taft. Here? Tonight. Hunter Taft was a thrice-divorced lawyer with silver hair, a silver tongue, and an abundance of charm. A man who wanted something from me I wasn't ready to give. A commitment. As if she sensed my desire to turn on my heel and leave, Libba rested her hand on the small of my back and propelled me into the room. "Paybacks are hell," I whispered. Libba's smile was sugary sweet. "I'll take my chances. Besides, you're going to have to talk to him at some point. Look, Laurie's waving at you." Laurie wasn't just waving. She was waving wildly as if I was a long-lost relative she'd spotted in a crowded airport. That wave, that talk-to-me-first wave, simply wasn't done. For so many reasons, not the least of which was that if I didn't go to her, she'd look like a fool. "Get it over with. Go talk to them," Libba advised, "then trade the wine in for something stronger." It didn't look as if I had much choice. Laurie wore a so-happy-to-see-you expression. Daisy looked bemused by Laurie's wild gesticulations, and Hunter, he'd noticed me. He raised a brow as if daring me to ignore him. I couldn't, ever. He'd helped me too many times. I owed him. My Italian pumps weighed more than a pair of anvils, but somehow I made it across the living room and presented my cheek for a kiss. "Ellison, you look lovely." And he looked handsome as ever. "Thank you, Hunter. It's nice to see you." That was it. I was out of words. "The kids are out tonight," Laurie announced. She made it sound as if Tripp was about to slip a ring on Grace's finger. I smiled, a tight, wordless smile. Laurie reached out and rested her hand on my arm. "We're so thrilled that Tripp is dating a girl like Grace." They were 16. It wasn't as if a few dates counted for anything. I found a few words. "Tripp said something about dinner and a movie. That's what he told me." Her grip on my arm tightened. "She's a lovely girl. You've done a fabulous job." Now I was supposed to say something nice about Tripp. What? "Tripp has impeccable manners." Next to me, Hunter made a noise in his throat. A guffaw. Hard to tell, since the polite expression on his face didn't waver. Tripp wasn't the only one with impeccable manners. "Daisy, how are your children?" I asked, a question guaranteed to elicit a 10-minute response. Laurie removed her right hand from my arm and placed her left hand on Daisy's arm. "I'm dying to hear all about your children, but I must talk with Prudence. Would you excuse me, please?" "Of course," said Daisy. Laurie hurried away. "Do you really want to know about the kids, or were you just trying to get rid of her?" Daisy looked and acted as sweet as cotton candy, so much so that sometimes I forgot all that sugary fluff hid an actual brain. "Of course I want to hear about the kids." "Me too," said Hunter. It must be a terrible burden to have impeccable manners. "Tom is playing basketball this year. Lewis thinks he's the next Mark Spitz and wants to swim year-round. Susan is taking private art lessons. Mary loves third grade. And since his father took him to a game, all Matthew wants to do is wear his Chiefs jersey and talk about football." Less than a minute. Something was wrong. "What? I have a confession." Daisy's voice was small. "Oh, dear." "What?" She fixed her gaze on the carpet. "I invited Laurie to sub for Jinx at our bridge game." "Where's Jinx?" She looked up, glanced at Hunter, and said, "Resting." A euphemism, if there ever was one. Of late, Jinx had been taking Valium at an alarming rate. "For how long?" "Until the new year." "Oh, dear Lord. Is she all right? Was there another incident?" Incident instead of overdose. Two could play the euphemism game. "No, absolutely not. She's fine. Preston took her to a lovely place out in Rancho Mirage. I mean, I assume it's lovely. Everything in Rancho Mirage is." Daisy clasped her hands together. Her brows drew together, and she bit her lower lip. "I hope you don't mind too much." Mind that Jinx was resting. How could I mind that? My brain kicked in. Daisy was worried about my reaction to Lori. It's fine. It wasn't. Lori's penchant for talking about the kids had already grown old. It's only for the month of December. Please. God. My gaze searched for and found Lori. She was deep in conversation with Prudence. As I watched, Prudence shook her head and blew cigarette smoke out her nose. You're nuts! Now that I was listening for it, Prudence's bray was easy to pick out among the voices filling Kay's living room. Lori said something, but unlike Prudence, she didn't bray. Her words were lost in the sea of conversations. Prudence shook her head and turned her back. Lori grabbed her arm. Prudence turned, stared at the hand on her arm, and curled the corner of her lip, revealing a few horse teeth. If you can't keep him happy, someone else will. Lori dashed her martini in Prudence's face. For a half a second, time froze. When it resumed, Prudence spluttered, dropping her drink and her cigarette. Shattering glass, the actual glass, not the coffee table, drew everyone's attention. Prudence stood immobile, Lori's drink dripping off the end of her long nose. Then she wiped away the drops of vodka with the back of her hand. Bitch! Adulteress! With the buzz of multiple conversations gone, it was easy to hear Lori's reply. Tom Michaels stepped forward. Lori, what the hell? Fire! Someone yelled. The chintz couch was producing black, acrid smoke. So much smoke that the sheep behind it were lost in a haze. Most of the people in the room stampeded toward the door to the hallway. Hunter raced over to Chester's bar and grabbed an ice bucket and a pitcher of water. He sped across the room to the smoking couch and dumped them both on the spot where Prudence had dropped her cigarette. Chester rushed after him with an armful of club soda and tonic bottles. Hunter took bottles from Chester's arms and poured the liquid onto the smoldering fabric. Our hostess pushed her way through the crowd, swimming against the stream. Her eyes were wide, and her mouth pulled back in a rictus of horror. What happened? Prudence Davies dropped a cigarette on your couch, said Daisy. Like me, she'd remained rooted to the Axminster, watching Hunter and Chester pour non-flammable liquids onto Kay's couch. Prudence had also remained. Kay, I'm terribly sorry. She actually sounded contrite. Kay's gaze traveled from the sodden remains of her couch to the smoke-darkened walls of her living room. Tears filled her eyes. How? It was Lori's fault. There was the Prudence I knew, the woman who blamed others for her sins. You're the one who dropped a lit cigarette on a couch. It was Lori who was braying now. After you threw a drink in my face. Prudence's cheeks were pale, her gaze furious. I'm not sleeping with your husband. He doesn't have enough imagination to keep me happy. Prudence shifted her attention to me, just for an instant, just long enough to remind me my husband had not lacked imagination. Daisy, God love her, moved closer to me. Tom, the man without imagination, covered his face with his hand and collapsed onto the undamaged couch. Prudence returned her gaze to Lori. You're pathetic. It's no wonder he cheats on you. Tom, who apparently lacked backbone along with imagination, opened his mouth, but said nothing. I could kill you. Lori's hands were cinched at her sides, and crimson flamed on her cheeks. She looked as if she meant what she said. Again, Prudence's gaze slid toward me. Get in line. Get out, Kay pointed to the door. No one moved. I mean it, Prudence. Get out. Me! Prudence's hands crossed over her chest. She started all this. Kay glanced at her ruined couch. You are not welcome here. You heard her. There was more than a hint of gloat in Lori's voice. You too, Lori. Kay's shoulders shook as if hysterics lurked around the next corner. Tom stood, moved to his wife's side, and took her arm. She shook him off. A dull flush rose from his neck to his face. Let's go, Lori. She turned on him, her mouth parted. You're making a scene. His was the voice of an observer, one who didn't particularly care if Lori made a scene or not. She snapped her lips closed and regarded the handful of people still in the room with narrowed eyes. Her gaze caught on Daisy and me, and she smoothed the expression on her face like a top sheet on a freshly made bed. Real emotion was replaced by polite dismay. She had caused a scene, an ugly one. Kay, She turned and faced our hostess. I am so sorry about all of this. Presumably, she meant the fire, the couch, and the scene. Of course, we'll go, and we'll replace the couch. Tom blanched. Remember this, Daisy whispered in my ear. What do you mean? I whispered back. This scene? Remember it. As if I could ever forget. Why? We'll be questioned. She nodded toward Lori, Prudence, Tom, and the tableau of ruined furniture. This is the sort of thing that leads to murder. 2. On Saturday morning, I stumbled into the kitchen, pushed Mr. Coffey's button, and plonked myself on a stool while he worked his magic. Grace wandered in and trailed, "Good morning," I grunted. "How was your party?" "Memorable. How was your date?" A silly question, since animated songbirds perched on her shoulders and whistled. "Fun." She opened the refrigerator door and peered inside. "Do you want some eggs?" Mr. Coffey gurgled. The best sound in the world. I lurched off my stool and poured myself a cup of heaven. "Coffee? Please. Do you want eggs or not?" I took a second mug from the cupboard. "Give me a minute to wake up and I'll make the eggs." "No, no," she spoke quickly, insultingly so. "I'll do the eggs. Maybe you could put some bread in the toaster." "Fine." Cooking was not my strong suit. No one ever taught me scrambled eggs could be cooked at low heat. It wasn't really my fault when Henry chipped a tooth. I opened the bread box and found, "What's this?" With the tips of my fingers, I held up a bag of raisin bread. "Aggie bought it." "Why?" I asked her to. "Why would you want to eat something defiled by raisins?" I dropped the bag on the counter and took a step back. "It's also got cinnamon in it. I tried it at Peggy's. It's good." I raised a doubtful brow. "You can make your own toast." Grace shook her head as if I was the one acting like a teenager. "That wouldn't do. How was the movie?" "Cute. It's about a dog who saves some kidnapped kids." She cracked eggs into a bowl, then beat them with a fork. "What happened at the party?" Prudence Davies dropped a lit cigarette on a couch and started a fire. "No way." "Way." Grace put a shallow skillet on the stove and lit the burner. "Wow, I bet Mrs. Brookfield was upset." "To put it mildly," she added a pat of butter to the pan. "What are you doing tonight?" "I had a date with Anarchy Jones, a date I didn't care to discuss. I hadn't yet consumed enough coffee to handle a teenage smirk. When Grace learned I was actually going out with him, she would smirk. When Mother learned I'd gone out with Anarchy, she'd sigh and sadly shake her head and mention something about disappointment. Mother disapproved of Anarchy. He was a homicide detective. He had no people in Kansas City, and his parents had given him an unacceptable name. Mother preferred Hunter Taft. "Why do you ask?" Grace cocked her head and smiled. "I was wondering if Peggy, Kim, Debbie, and Donna could spend the night?" "Of course." And then, because she'd relegated me to toaster duty, I added, "I'll make breakfast for you all in the morning." "Very funny, Mom." She poured the eggs into the pan and stirred them with the fork. I dropped a slice of raisinless bread into the toaster next to a piece of Grace's unspeakable bread, pushed down the lever, and sipped my coffee. We ate our breakfasts, perfect eggs, burnt toast, sitting at the island. "What are your plans for the day?" I asked. "Homework. If you'll give me some money, I'd like to go to the store for some snacks for tonight." "Of course." I imagined the girls piled onto the couch in the family room, watching the late movie, chomping on popcorn, giggling. Meanwhile, I'd be, "How much do you need? Is 20 too much?" "Nope." "Thanks, Mom. What are you up to today?" "Painting." My fingers itched for the feel of brushes in my hands. I drained my coffee cup and stood. "Thanks for the eggs." Grace did not thank me for the burnt toast. Imagine that. I painted, breaking only for lunch and, at Max's insistence, a quick run. Then I painted some more. The daubs on the canvas coalesced into real shapes and soothed every single one of my nerves. Painting did that for me. Allowed me to express emotions best not shared with my friends at the club. Anger and sadness and joy all ended up on the canvas, transformed by swirls of paint. Usually, anxiety joined those emotions. Not today. An anxious niggle refused to relocate to the painting. I gave up, cleaned and dried my brushes, and headed downstairs. Paint under my nails, a messy ponytail, and no makeup wouldn't do. I showered, dried my hair, and carefully applied my face. All the while, the niggle of nervous tension that had shadowed me all day grew. I bit my lower lip and peered into my closet. What to wear? I held up a Diane von Furstenberg dress, gazed in the mirror, shook my head, and tossed the frock on the bed. I repeated that exercise with three more dresses. When the fifth dress joined the growing pile on the coverlet, I paused. I was behaving exactly like Grace last night, unable to decide what to wear on a simple date. I returned the dresses to the closet and donned slacks and a cashmere turtleneck. Ding dong! My heart ricocheted around my chest. Mom! Grace's voice carried from the foyer. Detective Jones is here! Coming! I took a final peek in the mirror and grabbed my purse. I paused at the top of the stairs. At the bottom, four teenage girls were gazing at Anarchy as if he were Steve McQueen and they were the presidents of his fan club. Grace was less impressed, but she was used to Anarchy's coffee-brown eyes, lean face, and killer smile. She gazed at me, passed judgment on my outfit, and ultimately communicated her approval with a tiny nod. I descended, my gaze locked on the girls. Looking at them was preferable to looking at Anarchy. Just glancing his way made my mouth dry, made my lips twitch, made my spine tingle. I reached to the bottom of the stairs and he closed the distance between us, dropping a kiss on my cheek and whispering, "You look beautiful." My heart, an unreliable organ, behaved like the ball in an arcade machine. It bounced off other organs, tilted, and set bells ringing. Predictably, Grace smirked. Her friends gawked. "I'll get my coat." The voice wasn't mine. It was too high, too girly. I cleared my throat and added, "You girls have fun tonight." "You too, Mrs. Russell." They sounded like a Greek chorus. Anarchy and I stepped outside, and the cold chilled the fire burning my cheeks. "Where are we going?" The squeak had returned. I cleared my throat. Anarchy pulled open the passenger door. "Do you like steak?" "I do." My regular voice was back, thank God. He circled the car and settled in behind the wheel. "We're going to the Ox." "The Golden Ox?" The restaurant crouched next to the Kansas City Livestock Exchange and was a favorite with the ranchers who brought their cattle to the neighboring stockyards. Legend had it that the Ox was the birthplace of the Kansas City Strip. I'd never been. Best steak in town. Who was I to argue? "Do you go there often?" "Special occasions." I was a special occasion. My lips twitched and a warm glow settled into my stomach. "How was New York?" he asked. "Good. The painting sold well." "I haven't been there in years. Usually when I travel, it's to California." "San Francisco?" I asked. Anarchy's father was a politics professor and his mother a fiber artist. He never talked about them. He didn't, now. Instead, his lips thinned and he nodded. "Are you going home for the holidays?" He slowed the car for an upcoming red light. "I haven't decided yet." "Is it just you and your parents, or do you have siblings?" "I have a brother and a sister." "What do they do?" He stared at a traffic light and said nothing. When the light turned green, he pressed the accelerator. "My brother is an environmental lawyer, and my sister sings."
"Sings?"
"Songs." His jaw tightened, and his gaze remained fixed on the road ahead. The message was clear. He didn't want to talk about his family.
"What are their names?"
"River and Journey." That gave me pause. "Which is which?" He snorted, and the tight line of his jaw relaxed. "River is my brother, and Journey is my sister."
"River Jones."
"Journey Jones? How interesting." My mom wanted to name Journey Karma. My father liked Serenity. Journey was the compromise.
"What about River? Any discussion there?"
"Nope, they both loved River." The tight line was back with a vengeance. "Have you talked with your sister recently?"
"The surgery's coming up."
My sister, in a selfless act no one had believed her capable of, was donating a kidney to my first cousin. Mother and Daddy are flying to Akron to be with her. They'll stay for Thanksgiving.
You're not going?
Maybe. It's up to Grace.
Thanksgiving would be the first major holiday she'd spent without her father. All I wanted was for her to be happy, so I was following her lead. Thus far, she wanted to stay in Kansas City. We may stay home.
He pulled into a parking lot filled with pickup trucks and slotted his car into a space.
Do you cook?
Not if we want to eat.
Even I acknowledged that a turkey catching the oven on fire was a bad thing. If we stay here, we'll get takeout from the club.
Takeout? For Thanksgiving?
He opened his door, and the overhead light came on, illuminating the crinkles near his eyes.
Don't judge.
Anarchy walked around the car, opened the passenger door, and extended a hand. I had no choice but to take it. With his touch, an electric current raced from my fingers to my arm to my brain. My mouth dried, my tongue tied in knots. Somehow, I got out of the car and let him lead me into the restaurant. The carpet was a deep red, patterned with ranch brands and the faces of heifers with attitude problems. The chairs were leather. One wall was papered with a rustic scene of a cattle drive on the plains. There were saddles and mounted heads and a pair of longhorns above the kitchen. It was a place by men, for men.
You've never been here before,
he sounded surprised. Half the customers wore cowboy hats. A third wore leather vests. It was not the sort of place Henry would have taken me. Not the sort of place I'd lunch with girlfriends.
No,
you're in for a treat. I managed a weak smile. We followed the denim-clad hostess to our table and sat. I perused the menu. My choices involved cuts of meat, not types. The same range held true for sides. Potatoes, mashed, baked, or fried.
You don't come to the Ox and order a salad.
I wouldn't dream of it. I knew exactly what kind of salad I'd get. Tired iceberg lettuce with a few strands of shaved carrots, a cherry tomato or two, and croutons, all smothered in green goddess or buttermilk dill dressing.
Is it okay? We can go someplace else.
I stared across the table. Anarchy regarded me with scrunched eyes and worried lips. He was nervous, too.
Are you kidding? I love this place.
Somehow I managed a smile. Besides, I'm dying for a good steak. He smiled back at me. My smile was a simple curving of lips. Anarchy's was something else entirely. Anarchy's smile warmed his eyes and broke up the austere lines of his face. Anarchy's smile set electric currents zinging and hearts tilting. Anarchy's smile left me breathless. I took a sip of water, wished for something stronger, and shifted my gaze away. There were men at the bar who looked like fixtures. There were men in booths whose stomachs threatened to dislocate the tables. There were golden ox heads on the walls staring at me. We ordered steaks, hardly a surprise. The steaks arrived along with a bottle of red wine. The steaks and the wine were excellent, and the anxious niggle at the back of my brain stopped worrying about the actual date and concerned itself with its end, with saying goodnight. I wanted a goodnight kiss, long and slow and mind-melting. If I told her, Libba would say that wanting a kiss was a positive step for me. Then she'd talk about empowerment and sexual liberation, and as soon as she said sex, I'd stop listening. Instead, I'd recite the preamble to the Constitution in my head, or think about football players in pantyhose or paunchy men streaking in the park. What do you do for fun? The words spilled out of me, infinitely preferable to thoughts of kissing or paunchy naked men.
I have a motorcycle.
I knew it! I knew there had to be a hidden wild side to anarchy. His eyes narrowed slightly.
What?
I blinked.
What do you mean,
what?
You're smirking.
I am not. I was.
You're thinking, Easy Rider, it's not like that.
I am not. I wasn't. I never saw Easy Rider. Now, Anarchy blinked. My husband had no interest in seeing movies like that. So, of course, we hadn't gone to the theater.
Henry claimed the film glorified pot-smoking, LSD-dropping losers on motorbikes.
He'd been more interested in viewing Bob and Carol and Ted and Alice, open marriages being more his style. I took a sip of wine, a large one.
Anarchy rested his forearms on the table and leaned toward me. You didn't miss much.
It took me a few seconds to realize he was talking about Easy Rider and not wife swapping. I'm not exactly counterculture.
Neither am I. But he could have been. His name was Anarchy. With a liberal politics professor for a father, he probably hung out in Haight-Ashbury or wherever it was that hippies hung out before the 60s. Me? I'd been groomed to be a wife from the moment my head rested in my cradle, hardly a walk on the wild side. He picked up his wine glass, turning it so the liquid within caught the light. At some point in our lives, we decide what we're going to be, who we're going to be. He lifted the glass to his lips but didn't drink. My sister calls me a pig. My father, too. I'm sorry.
I'm not.
I would have liked to ask him more about his sister, but he frowned and his hand dropped to his waist. A second later, he was peering at a small black box, his pager. Would you please excuse me a moment? Something inside me, whatever it was, I refused to give it a name, deflated. I thought you were off tonight. Anarchy's frown deepened. I am. I'm sorry about this. Excuse me. He crossed the crowded dining room, presumably to find a phone, and I leaned back in my chair. Things had been going so well. I was close to learning something about his life, about him. And now, somewhere in the city, someone was dead and the dispatcher had paged Anarchy. He'd go. He wouldn't be Anarchy if he didn't. He'd go. And the leisurely kiss, the one dancing like sugar plums in my head, wouldn't happen. Not tonight. Not if Anarchy had to investigate a murder. I sighed. Disappointment or relief? Who was I kidding? Disappointment. He strode back to the table with our coats draped over his arm. Ellison, he scowled down at the carpet. A heifer scowled back. We need to leave. Now. A murder? I stood. He held my coat for me. No. No. I paused with my arm half in a sleeve, craned my neck and looked up into his grim face. What's happened? Dispatch notifies me whenever a call comes in from your address. His sentence hung there, as real as the scent of grilling meat, as real as the hammering of my heart. A disturbance. Grace's home. The voice wasn't mine. It belonged to a woman who couldn't catch her breath, a woman suddenly paralyzed by fear. He dropped a few bills on the table. Let's go. 3. My nose was inches from the dashboard, and my right foot pressed an imaginary gas pedal as if that would somehow make the car go faster. Did the dispatcher say what was wrong? No. Anarchy had bent the rules enough to put a flashy light on the top of his car, and we were speeding through traffic, not fast enough. But she didn't tell me anything, just that there was a disturbance call. A disturbance call? There was no way. No way Grace and her friends had caused a disturbance worthy of a call to the police. My heart beat in my throat, and I leaned even closer to the dash. Anarchy slowed for a red light, and I fisted my hands. Take it easy. Getting in a car accident won't get us there faster. He'd noticed my leaning or my clenched fists or my foot pushing its way to the pavement. Sorry. I settled back against the seat, forced my fingers apart, and eased up on the not-there gas. You're right. He looked both ways, saw no oncoming cars, and drove through the still red light. I leaned forward again. Ellison. His voice was velvet, meant to soothe. He reached across the bench seat, took my hand and squeezed, briefly. Then he returned his hand to 2 o'clock on the wheel. I closed my eyes and pressed my palms against my eye sockets. What if we're almost there? I peeked through the bars of my fingers. Anarchy was right. We were on my street. Cars lined the curb. Both curbs. Someone was having an enormous party. Anarchy slowed the car to a crawl. I looked for the house flooded with lights and people. Mine. I was hosting an enormous party, and if the police cars and scattering teenagers and empty beer cans littering my lawn were any indication, the party was a good one. She's grounded until she's 30. Anarchy snorted and pulled into the drive, parking at the bottom. The rest of the driveway was already filled with haphazardly parked vehicles. I didn't wait for Anarchy to open my door. I was out of the car before he'd even turned off the ignition. I charged up the drive in full mother mode, four friends to spend the night. Where was Grace? When I was done with her, she'd wish for Mother. Ma'am, a uniformed officer actually thought he could stop me. My steps didn't slow. My house! He wisely got out of my way. I pushed on the front door. It didn't budge. Apparently, the teenagers who remained in my house had decided their best course of action was to lock the door and wait out the police.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.